Namaskar. Welcome to this special course and special session on Bharatanatyam as the form of Bharata India. India has several dance forms: classical, folk, tribal, ritual, film, contemporary, and modern dances. One sees so many expressions of dance in our society. As students, one learns, sees, absorbs, explores, and understands various forms. But when we speak of classical forms, it means it has music, it has literature, it has Shastric knowledge, it has ancient and a tradition which has continued over centuries, which is what makes it classical. There are 8 major classical dance forms of India: Bharatanatyam, Kathak, Kuchipudi, Mohiniyattam, Manipuri, Odissi, Kathakali, and Satriya. There are also many varieties of folk dance forms. And folk dance forms means when one is celebrating harvest or seasons of sowing or reaping connected to our agricultural cycles. And all over India, in many states, we have many variety of these forms which are connected to either religious festivals or seasonal festivals. Some popular forms we know of are Bhangra of Punjab, Ras Leela of Uttar Pradesh, Garba of Gujarat, Ghumar of Rajasthan, Bihu from Assam, Lavani, Maharashtra. We have forms in Kerala like Devaratnam, we have Kummi Kolatam and Karakatakam of Tamil Nadu, we have Matki dance of Madhya Pradesh, Dolu Kunita of Karnataka. The forms are rich, the costumes are colorful, and their music is instant and live. Then we also have ceremonial or ritual dances, like we see in Kerala, the Tayyam forms for propitiating goddess Bhadrakali, or we have Kavadi Atam of Tamil Nadu. So the presentation of Indian dance styles in old as well as new films has also given a whole new genre of dance to our global audiences. Today, we all know how popular Bollywood style of dancing is, as also contemporary and modern choreography. But from all these forms and all these variety of ritual, tradition, modern, contemporary, film, Bharatanatyam, from the region of Tamil Nadu today, has become pan-Indian and global, and thus most learnt, performed, and one with outreach globally. This is one form which connects despite and in spite of language. For example, sometimes one may know Carnatic music or the language Tamil, Telugu, Kannada, or Sanskrit, and some may even not know these languages, but still learn this form. It could be in Kashmir, it could be in Assam, it could be in Baroda, it could be in parts of Kerala, that this form has reached all over India and all across the globe from India. It has a long history, starting in 2nd century BC, with an earliest reference found in a treatise called Silpadikaram. The earliest period known to Indian history of which we have recorded evidence is that of the Vedas, and dancing was practiced at that time. Dance finds mention right through Vedic literature, and the references reveal that not only was it a part of ritual, so common in early societies, but also a popular mode of creation and a coveted accomplishment. The next period that stands as a milestone in the pageant of early Indian history is that of the two great epics, the Ramayana and Mahabharata. Here too, we have ample evidence of the existence of dance as an art, as an activity, and as adjunct to ceremony. Next in importance are the Puranas, whose compilation began 1,000 years before Christ and concluded about the 10th century AD. Dancing was a well-developed and systematized art even in the time of early Puranas. It was held in such high esteem that there is a story in the Vishnu Dharmottara Purana the burden of which is that to be a good sculptor or carver, it is necessary first to have thorough grasp of painting, and to be a good painter, it is equally necessary first to acquire mastery of dancing. Important among other Puranas which make mention of dancing are Brahma Vaivarita, Skanda and Bhagavata. The Bhagavata Purana merits particular attention, for it carries a singularly elaborate and vivid description of the peak of Krishna's dances, the Rasleela. Bharata was a sage who postulated the fifth Veda, also called Natya Shastra. One of the very early texts on whole range of Indian literature, it is monumental work devoted to drama, dance, music and related arts and crafts and aesthetics. Written about 2nd century AD, this contains in its 37 chapters exhaustive material on practically every aspect of the performing arts, technique, presentation and appreciation. The material has all been scientifically analyzed and systematized and presented in a thoroughly organized manner. This obviously implies that the arts of dance, drama and music in India must have evolved and developed and reached a high degree of perfection and standardization even prior to the compilation of the Natya Shastra. Technical treatises such as Abhinaya Darpana, Dasarupaka and Sangeeta Ratnakara followed. Kalidas, who flourished about the 5th century AD, delineates in his Malvikagnamitram on how a dancer should perform, her deportment, her sense of timing, her involvement with the rendering, her communication with the beholder. Sudraka wrote one play, Mrichikatika, the little clay cart, where the principal character is a courtesan called Vasantasena, who by virtue of her profession is also a dancer. Panini, from 700 to 600 BC, wrote the Ashtadhyayi, the earliest manual of grammar, and while commenting on the root nritta, to dance, refers to Silalin and Krisasava, said to be authors of certain vital and codified postulates of dance. Kautilya, 4th century BC, wrote the first work on stagecraft, the Arthashastra, and from this we learn that arts such as dancing, acting, singing, playing on musical instruments and painting were then under state control, which implies that it was the responsibility of the state to maintain professionals in these fields. All these authors and texts belong to North India. Turning to the South, the oldest among the Dravidian languages is Tamil, and it has literature that dates from the dawn of the Christian era. The Sangam age lasted from approximately 500 BC to 580. The Tolkapiyam, Kuruntogai and Kalithogai reveal the existence of number of dances, practically all of which are of ritual nature. To the same period belong the great epic Silpadikaram and its sequel Manikameli. Both carry references to dancing, the former copiously touching every aspect of the art, its technique, teaching, presentation, repertoire. In fact, the story of Silpadikaram revolves around the infatuation of Kovalan, a wealthy merchant, for a dancing girl, Madhavi. Their illegitimate daughter, Manimekalai, provides the theme for the second epic named after her. The earliest architectural evidence of dance is found in Jaina rock cut caves. Jaina Prese Ilango, Adigal of the Chera dynasty, is credited with composing the Tamil epic Silpadikaram. The story of the anklet, with the central character of a dancer Madhavi, is a treasure trove of information on dance. The Natya Ganikai, as the dancer is called, is mentioned as having mastered dance and allied discipline of music for 7 years before her debut or arangetram on a stage of prescribed measurements. The stage is a simpler version of the stage mentioned in the Natya Shastra, the oldest treatise on Indian theatre of which dance was a part. Even hand gestures are mentioned, not to speak of categories like secular dance, as differentiated from ritual dance, abstract dance, as separate from interpretative dance, and of graceful movements as differentiated from their more vigorous counterparts. All of which points to an actively evolving art. Santi Kutu being the equivalent of classical dance, while popular forms of entertainment like gymnastics, puppetry and clowning were clubbed under Vinoda Kutu. Dance was always referred to as Atam or Kutu in the later years. Nataraj, the king of dance, came to be known as Adavalan or Kutan, a direct derivation from those two terms. Some scholars concur that Bharata was not one single person, but many who knew Bharata or Bharata, which is India. And thus, these wise men collectively prescribed the art of dramaturgy, which is Natya, not Nitya alone, to all who could become its practitioners or followers. The word Bharata also encompasses Bha for Bhava, Ra for Raga, Ta for Tala. Bha, Ra, Ta, Bharata, Bhava, Raga, Tala, thus leading many proponents to believe that Bharata Muni was more a concept than a person, though conclusive proof exists otherwise. Bharatanatyam was thus born as a divine form meant for auspicious celebration of divinity through dance and music. Unless all three ingredients, that is Shastra, literature, Sangeet, music and Sahitya, poetry, came together, dance could not be performed that would be understood. Module 1 of Bharatanatyam. The history of Bharatanatyam is long and continuous and ancient, but for practical purposes of our class, we take the last 200 or 300 years definitely with recorded evidence. The foundation for present-day Bharatanatyam was laid when King Tulaja II, whose dates and reign was 1763 to 1787, invited Mahadeva Natunar, a guru from Tirunelveli in Tanjore district, to his court in Tanjore. Tanjore and Tanjore are the same place. One is district, one is the capital of that kingdom. So often you hear the word Tanjore, which is traditional way of calling in Tamil culture, or Tanjore, which is the modern way and contemporary use of the same space. This Natunar Mahadeva came with two dancers, Vanajakshi and Matumunar, who presented a Varnam Gosala Tulaja Rajendra Raja dedicated to the king. It was very popular those days, as patronage demanded, that compositions were done in honor of the king, because that is how the king would be happy or invite the scholar and the Natunar to the court. So an ode to the king or a composition in praise of the king was normal and natural. Thus, this dance was at this point in time generally known by the name Sadir or Dasi Atam. Dasi being servant of the gods, and Sadir being the ancient continuity of a form which today is called Bharatanatyam. Bharatanatyam as a word came only in the last century, and there is good history behind it, which we will conduct in another class when we come to the subject. This was the period when the musical trinity, as we call three great composers of that period, the Carnatic musical trinity called Tyagaraja, Saint Tyagaraja, 1761 to 1847 was the period of his being. We have then Muthuswami Dikshitar from 1775 to 1834. And last but not least, Shyama Sastri, 1762 to 1827. These three, called the musical trinity, were famous for compositions that form a major part of the bedrock of the music called Carnatic, which accompanied this form called Sadir, Dasiyatam or as we study today, Bharatanatyam. The two Natuvanars, as the dance gurus were called, Gangaimuthu and Subraya Oduvar, also arrived at Thanjavur at the same time and were allotted a quarters or a small constructed building opposite the main temple called Natuvan Chavadi. Since they were Natuvanars, the place got to be named after them as Chavadi, Natuvanar Chavaneri. This is important because Thanjavur was under Maratha kingdom and Chavadi is a Maharashtrian word which is used even today, and Natuvanar was a Tamil word. So the combination of two cultures, as we see in this point in time, and we see the close connection between Thanjavur and the Maratha cultures. So commonality of words we also see both in written texts and in used traditions. After Tulaja the second comes the next king, Amar Singhe, from 1787 to 1789, and he shifted his headquarters to Tiruvadanai Maradur, another famous center for dancers and musicians like Ganam Krishnamayyar and Gopala Krishna Bharati, very famous composers of that period, and you often hear items composed by them. Their compositions or textual base are the material of which Bharatanatyam is made. Defying the ban on court dancing imposed in that period soon when East India Company came to India, the court patronized Sadir performances, and thus Subraya Oduvar produced four great sons who later took this whole tradition forward. Their names are now part of history. They are part of what we call Thanjavur Quartet, and the four brothers are Ponnaiya Pillai, Chennaiya Pillai, Sivanandan and Vadivelu, whom became legendary as the Thanjavur Quartet. Quartet means four. It means a foursome of a group of four people, and by providential circumstances they were brothers about the same time, so they could help develop a vast range of items into what could be performed simply in a short period in the court or in the temple. And later this is what we as a country, Bharata, India, inherited, the Margam format, which is Alarippu, the opening item, Jatiswaram, which follows Alarippu, which is a combination of Jatis and Swaram. Then we have Sabdam in praise, and Varnam, which tests both the technical and the expressional ability of the performer, the Nrita, as we call, and Nritya, and superimposed with Abhinaya through Padams, short love compositions in deity or praise or javalis of human beings, and the concluding Tillana, which says that everything has been propitiated in the form of a margam, which means marga, to follow a path. When one follows a path, it's a development and progression. And thus, the Thanjavur Quartet and Thanjavur became important for giving this structure of dance to an ancient form, which then slowly got to be known as we know it today, Bharatanatyam. Sarfoji II was the Maratha ruler of Thanjavur from 1798 to 1832. Thanjavur is also called as Thanjavur in Tamil, and under British India it got to be spelt more commonly as Thanjavur. This king, Sarfoji II, was a great patron of Bharatanatyam and himself wrote many Nirupanams for dance in Marathi language, which that was the official language of the period and the royalty, but in Carnatic ragas. In his time, there were 18 items in Bharatanatyam performance, and these were Jayastuti, Sharanu, Sharanu, Allaru, this was perhaps Allarippu, Chollu, Sabdam, Varnam, Padam, Swarajati, Abhinaya Padam, Tillana, Abhinaya Padam, Jakini Padam, Geetam, Prabandham, Tripta, Shlokavarnam, Kautvam and Mangalam. Sarfoji patronized the Thanjavur Quartet, who reduced the 18 items to 8 and introduced the Margam, which is now in force and in practice. many of the principal compositions that make up a margam, that complete suite of dances in a concert program, were first composed specifically for dance in the early 19th century by Ponnaiah Pillai. He was born in 1804 and one of the Tanjore Quartet, who was both a musician and dance master. The repertoire in modern Bharatanatyam can be said to date from that period, their repertoire being regarded as the most traditional. The full classical Bharatanatyam recital is divided into six or more discrete pieces, each of which belongs to a well-defined category on the basis of its music and the content of the dance. The name of each dance piece usually identifies the musical form to which it is set. For example, Varnam, Jatiswaram, Sabdam, Padam, Javali and Tilana are the names of the musical forms and also of the dances choreographed to that music. These pieces are identified on the basis of the musical content and the choreographic conventions to which these dances are set. All these generic terms, for example, there are many Jatiswarams and Varnams, etc., which while the dances have the same name, the choreography for each of them varies. There are numerous options, but dance steps must be structured to conform to the established general patterns. Within each category, the musical compositions can have a different tala or rhythmic structure, different raga or musical structure, and different sahitya, lyrics, where they are present. The songs are generally in Telugu, Sanskrit, Tamil or Kannada. Recently, songs in various regional languages such as Marathi, Hindi and Bengali have been set to dance. Naturally, audiences are more appreciative if the songs are in language that they understand. The margam carefully prepares the dancer and audience for a gradual increase in tempo, emotion and exaltation, creating a wonderfully complete and symmetrical art. Traditionally performed solo, the dancer leads the audience through an entire spectrum of experience, creating an intimate conversation between the observer and the observed. Such element of the margam can be viewed from the most mundane and relative orientation to mere details of day-to-day life, to the most profound and absolute expressions of the dancer's love and longing for undifferentiated communion with divinity. The Alaripu, which marks the dancer's entrance, is a crisp introduction to the basic grammar of movement in Bharatanatyam. Rendered to a recitation of rhythmic syllables, it has kinetic symmetry. Movements fan out from and converge on the center of the body with the weight balanced on both feet. It is a warming up process, like the worshipper entering the temple gateway with the mind uncluttered by the mundane concerns of life. The Jatiswaram introduces melody and abstract rhythms get an extension, the patterns being dictated by the solfa music arrangements. This is like moving on to Agra Mandapa or Four Hall. Then comes the Mandapa entry, which is symbolized in the Sabdam, where the interpretative part appears along with music and rhythm. When one enters the Ardha Mandapa and the Sanctum, one is in the presence of the deity. The Varnam, the central part of the recital, in which both interpretative and rhythmic dance attains full flowering, marks this movement. This is the acid test for the dancer, testing her stamina, skill and proficiency. After the Varnam's climax, the dancer is in intimate communion with God. The quietude of the moment signified by the Padam, which is purely based interpretation without rhythmic flashes. The Padam and Javali are conceived in Shringar mode. Finally comes the Tilana, a blaze of rhythmic aplomb. Bala Saraswati compared the structure of the performance to that of a journey a devotee takes in the temple. The Bharatanatyam recital is structured like a great temple. We enter through the Gopuram outer hall, which is Alarippu, cross the Ardha Mandapam halfway hall of Jatiswaram, then we enter the Mandapam or the great hall of Sabdam and enter the holy precinct of the deity in the Varnam. In dancing to Padams, one experiences the containment and the simple and solemn chanting of sacred verses in the closeness of God. The Tilana breaks into movement like the final burning of camphor, accompanied by measure of din and bustle. While the dance form is 2000 years old, the codified margam structure is just about 200 years old. Thus we see that the Tanjore Quartet, musicians under royal patronage and platform, set the format where a presentation began with Alarippu and ended with a Tilana. In between, set course of compositions or items could be performed to show both Nritya technique and Nritya expressional aspect of dance. Each served a purpose of warming up, energizing various chakras from head to toe and activating the energy cells, thereby leading to culmination or joyous release through the divine art of dance. Bharatanatyam thus was not mere dance, but yoga set to music. Bharatanatyam today then is the most learned classical style in India and internationally. We've seen its continuous history from the times of Silpadikaram to Tanjore Quartet to how the form from Dasyatam became Bharatanatyam. Today it has many exponents, it has vast repertoire, and it has mass appeal from amongst all the classical forms. It is performed on all occasions, all types of stages, indoors, outdoors, and on all opportunities. It has in fact become very popular in films, fashion, and branding abroad. Bharatanatyam has thus come to be recognized as the most popular and practiced classical form, and today it represents the dance of Bharata, India.